Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Educated Child, A Parent's Guide from Preschool through Eighth Grade by William J. Bennett with Chester E. Finn, Jr. and John T.E. Cribb, Jr. Read by Murphy Geyer with an introduction read by William J. Bennett.
Hello, this is William Bennett. My colleagues, Chester Finn, John Cribb, and I have written The Educated Child. We hope this program will help you provide the best education possible for your child from preschool through eighth grade. All parents want their child to be well-educated, but it's a task that has become more and more difficult, even as it has become more and more important. Pressures of time and work distract us from it. Often the temptation is to let others take charge. Child care professionals, curriculum directors, counselors, even children themselves. However, education remains one of the most important duties a parent has. The psychologist Yuri Bronfenbrenner of Cornell has said that the one indisputable condition for a child's success is to have at least one adult who has a deep and irrational attachment to him. In other words, someone who is absolutely crazy about him. There is no doubt about it. When it comes to your child's education, your own devoted attention is an essential ingredient. For me, the educated child is the end result of much work I've done throughout my career. Education has been a constant theme for me in many of my tasks. I began by teaching philosophy, and perhaps the greatest philosopher of all, Plato, said that the education of the young is the central task of any community. I learned much about American education as the chairman of the National Endowment for the Humanities, and then as Secretary of Education under President Reagan. Later, as President Bush's drug czar, I learned more about the problems facing some of our schools and students. However, the most important experience has come, sometimes the hard way, as my wife Elaine and I have raised our two sons, John and Joe. Another of my books, The Book of Virtues, focused on a certain type of education, the education of character. While this program includes a section on character education, its scope is broader. The educated child addresses the academic basics, English, history, geography, the arts, math, and science, as well as other areas that have a crucial bearing on your child's learning. Topics such as good study habits, the dangers of illegal drugs and alcohol, and the problem of too much television watching. Unfortunately, we have been failing far too many children in this country by not giving them a good education. Too many schools are underperforming, and despite what you may believe or may want to believe, your child's school is likely underperforming too. And sadly, some parents are not putting forth the necessary efforts. This program, however, is a program of optimism. It's based on the premise that when parents get involved in the learning process, good things happen. You are your child's first teacher, his most important teacher, his indispensable teacher. You have more at stake in your child's education than anyone else, and you are in a position to make the most difference in that education. We have not filled this program with technical jargon. Most of what makes up a good education can be discovered by straightforward common sense. Unfortunately, many so-called experts have convinced people that only they, education professionals, know what a good education entails. As we can see from the last few decades, their advice and policies have not always been good for students. The truth is, there is nothing mysterious about what makes good students and good schools. We spell out the basics here. Trust your common sense. Keep your eyes open. Make learning a top priority. And the power is yours to help your loved one learn to his potential. The ideas, strategies, and suggestions included here are intended as education equalizers. That is, they don't depend on how much money you have, the color of your skin, or your own educational background. Your attitudes and efforts are more important to your child's academic success than family income or the number of diplomas hanging on your wall. A parent who is a high school dropout but who now has a firm desire and strong commitment to education will be infinitely more valuable than a parent with a doctorate and an attitude of indifference. In what's to follow, while reminding you of basic responsibilities, we also offer some different ideas about how to fulfill those duties. You do not have to attempt all or even most of the specifics we recommend. Some will be better suited than others for your child and your particular school. We leave it to you to choose among them. Finally, remember that no parent can be perfect. All of us, and the authors are certainly included here, can do a lot better. The most any of us can do is try our hardest for our kids. The higher we aim, the better off they will be. Children and schools rise with parents' expectations. And the best way to lift our young people is to lift our own sights and standards. We wish you well. Your children are counting on you.
There is an old saying that a parent's heart is the child's schoolroom. Parents' dreams, efforts, examples, and loving exhortations set the boundaries of their children's education. The seminal lessons taught in the home stay with children as they make their way through school and life, shaping their interests, ideals, and enthusiasm for learning. Parents are their children's first and most important teachers. Raising their children is their number one job. Seeing that those children get a good education is, in many respects, the crux of that task. It is not only the task of parents, but the task of all of us in our communities. We all need to understand the current issues in education if our community's children are to get an excellent education. Though we speak directly to the parent about the education of his or her child, grandparents can apply what's said to their grandson or granddaughter. Aunts and uncles can apply what's said to their nieces and nephews. And community members can apply what's said to all the children in the local elementary school. As citizens, we all need to know, what are the signs of a good school and what does a good school teach? What are the warning signs of a weak program in one of the core curriculum subjects like English or math? What are some of the crucial issues in education, and how does your local school measure up? Does your school include character education? And how does a school teach character? Not least, how can we bring about change in that blob known as the education establishment? You'll want to use what you learn here as the starting point for investigating the specifics of what your child should be learning and what you should be asking your child's teacher. Whether you are a parent or community member, here you will find a measure of common sense, which in our time is very much needed in education. There are more than a few so-called experts in this field who act as though education is an arcane science that only highly trained professionals like themselves can really fathom. Sometimes they make us feel unqualified to judge what is happening in our schools and our children's lives. They spout jargon and invoke theories to justify low expectations and achievement. Degrees, certificates, credentials, fancy terms, none of these guarantees a good education, and you should not be intimidated by them. In truth, it takes no special expertise to judge a school. You don't have to be a shoemaker to know that the shoe doesn't fit. You don't have to be a curriculum developer or district superintendent to know that a child's education isn't going right. You may not feel comfortable judging a specific lesson or teaching method, but if you pay attention to what a child is learning, you can get an accurate sense of whether the school is doing a good job overall. Think of what you'll learn here, then, as common sense plus. It can reaffirm your own prudent judgment, plus give you some solid ideas about what a good education looks and feels like. What are the lessons that good schools teach? We often attach the most importance to higher education, yet elementary school has a far greater impact. Except for family and church, no institution is so influential. We ask elementary schools to help shape our students' first and lasting ideas about themselves, their country, and the world. We expect them to teach basic knowledge and nourish the appetite for learning. In the kindergarten through eighth grade years, children gain, or fail to gain, skills they will need throughout their educations and careers. They develop habits and values they will carry the rest of their days. Elementary school is an invitation and encouragement to a fulfilled life. In educational significance, its mission dwarfs all others. Good elementary schools share a certain character or ethos. It takes no expertise to recognize whether a school is doing right by its students. You can begin to get a good sense of it just by spending a little time in its classrooms and corridors. Good schools attend to the basic subjects: English, history, geography, math, science, art, and music. They don't clutter the curriculum with so many other topics that the basics get pushed aside. Students know that learning this core curriculum is serious business. Good elementary schools concentrate on essential skills. Perhaps most of all, that means teaching students how to comprehend the written word. Reading is the heart and soul of elementary education. If a child goes on to high school unable to read fluently, his chances for academic success are in great peril. Other vital skills also need to be mastered before eighth grade. We expect elementary schools to teach children to speak and write well, to add, subtract, multiply, divide, and measure things, to think logically and clearly, to ask good questions, analyze problems, and search for correct answers. Knowledge is just as important as skills. Good elementary schools recognize that there are some facts and ideas that all American students should know. For example, they teach students what a right triangle is, what happened in 1776, where the Earth is in our solar system, what a Trojan horse is. Good schools spell out for parents the fundamental knowledge they intend to transmit. Teaching it is serious work, not a chance byproduct of learning skills. Elementary schools hold the responsibility of transmitting to each new generation what may be called our common culture, the things that bind Americans together as one people. In its highest form, this common culture is the sum of our intellectual inheritance, our legacy from all the ages that have gone before us. It is the knowledge, ideas, and aspirations that shape our understanding of who we are as a people. Our common culture is found in documents such as the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence, in principles such as the belief that all men are created equal, and in events from our past, such as the landings of the Mayflower at Plymouth and the Eagle on the Moon. It lies in great stories and poems, such as Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol and Emma Lazarus's The New Colossus. Americans of all backgrounds want schools to acquaint children with our common legacy. As the journalist Walter Lippmann once observed, no culture can survive that is ignorant of its own traditions. Teaching cultural literacy is part of the effort of raising good citizens. This task, too, belongs in considerable part to the elementary school, to help lay the groundwork for young people's eventual entry into the democratic community of responsible adults. Teachers acquaint pupils with their rights as well as their duties to their fellow citizens and their country. Teddy Roosevelt once said, "The first requisite of a good citizen in this republic of ours is that he shall be able and willing to pull his own weight." Good schools teach such civic virtues. They help children learn to live up to their obligations, not to shrink from toil, and to give others the respect they are due. They teach them to recognize America's faults, but also to offer this country the great honor it deserves. They help children become, in Madison's words, loving critics. In that vein, good elementary schools help parents develop character in children. They never lose sight of the fact that the formation of intellect and character go hand in hand. In training young hearts and minds toward the good, they make conscious efforts to inculcate virtues such as self-discipline, diligence, perseverance, and honesty. Teachers cultivate these traits largely through the formation of habits, getting to class on time, being thorough about assignments, saying yes, ma'am, and yes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.